You were at Sandhurst, weren't you, before you trained at Sandhurst, didn't you?
Oh, yes, I was at Sandhurst.
Yes. What did you think of that? Was that happiest time of your life? Or?
18 months. Fantastic. Really? Discipline was very strict.
Yes.
But the free time with all the games and the sports available,
yes,
marvellous. And I made some very close friendships there.
Yes.
The war and so on.
Yes. Why do you say it was fantastic? Just because of the sport?
Hmm?
You say it was fantastic. Was that just because of the sport?
Oh, no. Free time and so on and the things one could do.
Yes. Yes.
Yes.
And then after that, you were in the Indian Army.
I went from there to India.
Yes.
Although my cousin was a general and wanted me to the King's Regiment, General Harrington, the King's Regiment, he had me up and said, I want you to come to my regiment, and I had to gracefully decline. I had forebears in the Indian Army, and the pay was much better,
okay,
all the sport and so on. So that's what happened.
Right, so Indian Army, and what sort of sport were you doing? Were you doing polo?
Yes, I played polo. I hunted big game shooting.
Did you?
And, yes, ordinary shooting, but big game as well. And
so what did you shoot as big game?
Well, the small game and so on.
Is that boar?
Deer
wild
and
boar.
So on.
Oh, yes.
That we only shot them for food when we were in the jungle camping. So
yes,
on.
Yes.
But the big game, I shot a tiger, and that of course was the highlight of my life at that time.
Yes, yes. What did you do with the tiger? Did you get the skin?
Yes, one of the family have got it now. The
have
children.
They? Mm. Have they? And it's still okay, is it, after 80 years or
yes,
something?
Yes, I think so.
Really?
Yeah, I've got it.
Yes, yes. How long were you in the Indian Army?
16 years.
16.
And I was in the Army altogether 35.
Right.
And I transferred from the Indian Army to the British Army in 1947.
That was after partition then?
At the time of partition.
At the
yes.
time of partition.
That's right.
So you were there before partition?
Oh, yes.
And how was it then? I mean, apart from the sport, what were you involved in?
Oh, well, there were only three battalions of my regiment.
Yes.
First Last Dover Rajputs. Men about so high, but almost as white as you or I. They were hillmen, you see. And
so did they come from? They would have come from the northern
region. That's right. Yeah,
near
yeah.
Nepal or from Nepal.
We were on the northwest frontier.
Okay.
Forts all around the place, Jamrud, Shargai, so and so on. We did 3 months in each fort, and either chased the tribesmen or we got chased. And then every third year, we came down to the plains. And but our main business was northwest frontier of India.
Yes, keeping the tribesmen at bay.
That's right.
Keeping the Afghans out.
Yeah.
Really?
Yes.
Yes. Yes. They're still doing it, aren't they? They've still got trouble with the tribesmen.
No.
I think they have. Is that happy memories?
Oh, very. In India?
Yes.
Oh, I was very lucky.
Tell me a little bit about it. Tell me why it was so happy.
Well, it was a wonderful life. And, what more can I say? It was a very life. It was we were busy. And there were only 12 British officers in the regiment with a doctor making 13. And we were a very close companionship. And the leave was very good. 2 months every year. 3 months when we were down on the plains, which reduced the number of officers to four in the from about April to September, and then we were back to normal strength after that.
Yes.
People are on leave or on courses. Or,
but you've got 13 officers. How many men are you in charge of?
About 800.
About 800.
Yeah.
Tell me about, because I can't imagine it. One, I haven't been in the army.
No.
And although I've been to India, I was as a teacher. And
were
I,
you?
Yes. And so I know nothing about your life in the army. I want to know what your day-to-day life, when you're not out big game hunting and...
We're training our soldiers and all.
Yeah.
Just a normal military life. Nothing special about it.
I know, but I don't know what the normal military... So I want you to tell me. I know nothing about it, so I want you to tell me.
What more can I say than it's a normal military life?
Getting up in the morning early... Getting your soldier on a parade ground, or what?
Yeah, in the hot weather, you got up early parade, and then you finished by the 11 or 12 o'clock because it was too hot.
Mm.
Temperature was well into the 30s, you see, isn't it? But it wasn't overbearing because Peshawar, Lundikotel, you know, the Khyber Pass, the heat was dry, and so it wasn't overpowering.
Mm-hmm.
But Calcutta or Bombay, very hot and sticky.
And did you have bearers to look after you? Did you call them bearers?
Yes, I had to have two.
Yes.
I had an orderly, a soldier, a sepoy, who was a Hindu, you see. We were first class Jogi Raj, which was all Hindus.
Yes.
And he did all my clothes and all that sort of thing and accompanied me everywhere I went when we were chasing the tribesmen. And then in the mess we had to have Muslims because... they'd cook the food and so on, but it was a question of drink, and the Muslims didn't drink, so we had to have the Hindu waiting in the mess, the sepoys.
Yes, so the sepoys, the Hindus would serve the drink, would they?
The Hindus, yes, the Dogra would, but not a Muslim.
Yes.
But
the Muslims wouldn't cook pork, would they? The Muslims wouldn't cook pork, would they?
No.
And the Hindus won't cook beef.
No.
That? Yes.
That's right.
So that's a little bit complicated.
Yeah, well, yes. And then after I came out of Burma...
You went from the Khyber Pass and then left the Indian Army?
No. It came down to... I went to Burma. My war was in Burma, not in the Western Theatre at all.
Yes. But when you were in Burma, were you in the British Army or the Indian Army?
No, I was in my... But I'd been to the Staff College.
Yes.
And so most of my time in Burma, I wasn't with my regiment, but I was doing staff jobs.
Oh. What does that mean?
Well, that means, what more can I say, it was on the staff directing.
Right.
As opposed to being a soldier.
So more or less sitting behind a desk, are you? Sitting behind a desk?
Oh, yes, and going out and visiting units and so on. Oh,
yes.
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 In the war, you take everything into account and get on with it.
Yes. And how did you like Burma?
No. I had no time for them at all.
Really?
No.
Why was that?
I didn't trust them.
And you would trust the Indian soldiers?
Oh, totally. They never believed when I finally said goodbye to my orderly that I had for 10 years, and they would never believe that we were leaving India for good.
Yes.
And
so did they think of that as a betrayal?
Betrayal?
Yes, did they think that it was a sort of betrayal that the English should leave?
I don't call it, no. It was just that Hindustan wanted to be themselves, and Pakistan, the Muslims, they were themselves.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, I wouldn't call it a betrayal, no.
But did they think of it as a betrayal?
They didn't like it.
They didn't like it.
The respect for the British officer in India was absolutely marvellous, and we were very close.
Do you remember their names? Do you remember their names?
Oh yes, I can remember their names. Until fairly recently, I used to be getting a Christmas card every year from my old regiment.
Did you? Yes.
17th Dogra Regiment.
Yes. Yes. And why do you think that Burma was not the same?
I don't know. I didn't like it much. I didn't trust them.
I wonder what the difference was between the Burmese and the Indian soldier then that they didn't trust.
Very different. They were very different. I didn't trust them. But there we are.
Did they trust you?
Oh, totally.
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
The war that you were fighting in Burma was, it also involved the Japanese, didn't it?
Well, we eventually fought the Japanese, yes, that's right.
Yes. But before that, before the Japanese were involved, what was the British Army involved in?
We occupied Burma, we started in Rangoon.
Yes.
And then the Japanese invaded it, as you see, so we had to, the first part was when they invaded Rangoon and so on, we retreated, and then we crossed the River Chindwin at Imphal, and a brigade took over from us. It's the first time we'd been disengaged from the enemy. And we were having a conference one evening. We just crossed the Chindwin River and out of contact with the Japanese, the brigade that took over from us. Somebody came up to me, with a paper called The Statesman. And there I saw in the paper that my son had died in Pachmari in India, 8 months old.
That is a terrible thing to happen.
My general was, he said, you take 10 days leave immediately. So I said, no, I won't until I had to go back further from Imphal and lay out where all the battalions of the brigade were to be. And so I didn't go 10 days, and my wife came down to Calcutta from Pachmari,
mm-hmm.
In the central provinces. And then...
Was your son born out there?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. And eventually... I was posted to Agra.
Yes.
Taj Mahal.
Yes.
And we had a bungalow, and we had 13 servants, just for the two or three of us. And every full moon, we'd go and picnic.
By the Taj Mahal.
To look at the Taj Mahal.
Mm-hmm.
It's absolutely fantastic. And then all the other places around there.
Now, to us these days, having 13 servants for just two of you seems quite a lot. Having 13 servants seems quite a lot. What did they all do?
It's a caste system.
Yes. What did they all do?
Well, 30. Oh.
You had a Mali?
Well, you start the lowest caste. Who,
right.
They're the caste systems. They're the lowest caste. They used to look after the loo, the toilets, all that sort of thing. And then you had a consarma, a cook.
What?
You had to have a watchkeeper, a cleaner, and so on, and the various other servants. But that was about the minimum if you lived in a bungalow.
Yes. You had a marley? You had a marley?
Yes, had a marley.
Yes.
You know what that is?
Yes, I do. Yes, I do. And how much of the language did you speak at that time?
You had 3 years to learn Urdu.
Yes.
The first class and the second class, and the second class and the first class.
Did you learn that while you were in India or back in San... Okay.
Oh, yes.
Yes.
And you take the exams. I managed to pass the exams in 2 years. And you had to be able to not only speak it, which you had to be able to write it. And of course you wrote right to left.
Yes.
And you had to read a book called Hamare Sawari Sipai, which was the cavalrymen and the sepoys, and it's written in Urdu, and you had to be able to read it. Having done that and passed the exams, we always had English clerks. I never read another piece of Urdu again.
So you wouldn't be able to remember it now?
Oh, I can still speak the language, yes.
Can you?
It's a long time ago.
Yes. And did you speak Hindi as well? Did you speak Hindi as well?
Urdu.
Just Urdu, yes. Yes.
Yes.
And all the people in the Indian Army and the English Army that was over there all spoke Urdu?
Oh, well, yes, they did, yes.
Yes.
Yes,
good.
Gurkhas spoke Gurkhali.
Did you speak that?
No, I wasn't with the Gurkhas.
Yes,
you know. Yes. No. And then at partition, I sent Nora home early because I saw what was going to happen, right? And I got out. We were given the choice on partition. You could stay in the Indian Army if they wanted to. You could be given a sum of money for loss of career, which they didn't tell you how much would be.
Mm-hmm.
Or if the British Army would have you, you would transfer to the British Army. Well, I made up my mind immediately because I liked soldiering. I said I'd transfer to the British Army, which I did.
Yes. But it was already known the chaos that would happen after partition.
Oh, there was war. But yes.
Muslim and Hindu.
I missed it. And I remember when I was in Delhi doing a staff job, headquarters of the Indian Army. When I went by train from Delhi to Bombay to get a steamer to England, I saw bodies stacked on the railway stations where they'd been fighting each other.
Yeah.
So I didn't stay to do the fighting with my regiment.
Yeah.
Because I'd made up my mind to transfer to the British Army, I was one of the first to go.
Yes. But it's strange, isn't it? Because within the Indian Army, you had, in close proximity, you had Hindus and Muslims working together.
Perfectly.
So it is strange, isn't it, that the minute the partition happened, they were at each other's throats.
Yes, yes. Oh, yes, there were a mixture of some regiments, Muslim and Hindus.
Yes, and getting on perfectly well.
Oh, yes.
So did the politicians among them stir it up, or... How did it happen that they suddenly turned on each other?
Well, they each wanted to look after themselves, I suppose. I don't know the details.
Mm-hmm. What point in your career did you go off to Burma?
Oh, I was with my regiment, and I think it was 1941.
Oh, right. Yes.
And I was... sent to the staff college.
Yes.
And 6 months up in Quetta, the staff college. Yes. And at the end of the course, they said, oh, you've got to come back as an instructor. Well, that's the highest compliment you could get paid as an officer. And I said, no way. I am limited in my, I'm not very good facing a lot of highly intelligent officers arguing and so on. So they didn't send me to the staff college, but they sent me to Burma instead in 1941.
I see.
We arrived on the last ship to Rangoon, and Rangoon was empty with clouds. They were never seen. They set the oil fields on fire, you see, before we retreated.
Yes.
And I joined my unit. And I was what's called a DOQNG of the 1st Burma Division. And that's where I served with my when I was in Burma.
Yes. Can you tell me who had set the oil fields on fire? Who had set the oil fields?
Oh, the British.
Oh.
Oh, yes. Mm-hmm. And we destroyed the railway too, so the Japanese.
Yes.
Or part of the railway.
Because the other important thing coming from Burma is the rubber, isn't it? Is it rubber? Do we not all have rubber plantations in Burma?
Yes, oak. What is the best? Burma, yes. The teak wood and so on.
Right,
yeah.
Yes.
I don't trust them.
You don't trust them?
No.
It's interesting that you can say that about the whole nation. You don't trust any of them. But in India, you didn't feel that.
No, I don't. I came across several of them sometimes, and anyway, no, I don't trust them.
Yes. So it's 1947 that you come back to Europe.
Yes, I came back to, Aldershot.
Did you?
And they reduced me from Lieutenant Colonel, but I'd been a Grade 1 staff officer. And I had a unit from Aldershot right down to Penzance. And I was only there, I don't know how many months, and the Berlin airlift started. I don't suppose you remember.
I funnily enough, I do, but not in an adult way. I just remember it as a phrase.
Well, I'd had a lot of experience doing, after I came out of Burma, and I got a staff job in Shillong, helping organise the air supply into Burma.
Yeah.
And when I transferred to the British Army, although I was commanding units, only a major's command down to Penzance, somebody thoughtfully read my CV, and so when the Berlin airlift started, I got my rank back and was flown into Gatow to help run the Berlin airlift. And then, having set all that up and so on, we went to the sending end. And we were flying over 2,000 tons of coal a day into Berlin. The Americans came in and took over from the British. And it was my job, four train loads, and each aeroplane had to be loaded separately because of the centre of gravity of each aeroplane. So it was my job to organise the loading of the aircraft and sending it. And the other end, of course, was receiving it.
Yes. So you were on the sending end. And mostly, was it coal, or was it what else were you sending? Mostly coal. Very difficult, I imagine, if you've got different aeroplanes, different centres of gravity, you've got to arrange it so that...
when the Americans came in, they had B-52 bombers.
Right.
There was no problem.
Yeah.
It was a different problem before the British pulled out. We only had a few planes. It wasn't difficult.
Yes. Yes.
So
did you see much of Berlin? Or did you see anything of Berlin?
Oh, yes. Yes. And the going behind the wall and so on. Yes,
yeah.
I did. I saw quite a lot of Berlin.
Yes.
And then the sending end was for the Americans, a place called Fassburg.
West Germany.
And there were three lines there of the entrances which the British and the Allies could fly into Gatow and the American base. The Russians, you see, behind there with all their tanks ready to march in, but we managed to keep the peace.
Did you see or have any contact with the Russians, or were they just over there?
No contact at all. We could see them.
Yes.
Tanks all lined up, ready.
Yes.
No contact with them.
And how did you find it working with the Americans?
Marvellous. When they first came to Fassburg,
yes,
they arrived. When they arrived, they didn't know how many aeroplanes they'd got or anything until they settled down.
You mean they were a bit disorganised?
Well, everybody arrived at once, but they soon got it right.
Yes. Did you enjoy working with them?
Yes.
What was it about them you enjoyed?
Well, it's with them. Working with them.
Yes.
They were very... we had great cooperation.
Oh, good. Yes. They, of course, would have had better supplies, I mean better food than the British Army, I imagine, because after the war, Europe was very impoverished, and the Americans seemed to have plenty of everything.
Oh, no problem at all.
No problem.
No.
Did they share?
It was rather a privilege. We were able to go into what they called, they had a superstores and
yes,
was able to go in there and buy things.
Yes. Which we didn't have. Which we didn't have, did we?
Yes.
And after Germany?
After Germany, I came back to England and got a staff job at what was then called the War Office, now the military...
Ministry of Defence?
Yes.
Yeah.
A promotion. Oh, I came back then to command my regiment in Aldershot.
Uh-huh.
Then I went to Germany on a staff job.
Yes.
Came back to London, the War Office again, doing another staff job. And then after that, back again to Germany to command. I commanded my corps in the Rhine Army. And I was about to... I'd been congratulated. We had two major generals in my corps, and I'd been congratulated when he came to the inspector, you see. You had a director and an inspector, two major generals in the War Office. And when he got out of the aeroplane, he congratulated me on going to become a major general. And then, all of a sudden, the people in the War Office, the people who run all the finances, downgraded, I don't know how many major generals' appointments, to brigadier. So they kept me on as a brigadier to get my full pension. And that was it. But I've no grouse because the army was closing down, but these things happen.
Yes. And do you look, having had a whole career in the army, do you look at the world and what is happening?
Terrifying.
Do you find it terrifying?
I find it incomprehensible.
Do you remember what Eisenhower said at the end of World War II? And he said, beware the military-industrial complex. Do you remember him saying that?
No, I don't.
He was very worried about business, the business of making arms, being too close to the military and what would happen then. So I wondered, what is it that you find terrifying now? Is it the sort of arms?
Yeah. One of the things, I think it was a bit of a sop because I wasn't Major General, I was made an ADC to the Queen.
Yes.
Which is a...
That's quite an honour.
Oh yes, very much so. She's my pin-up girl.
Is she? Oh, so she is, I see her. Yes, above the birds and the butterflies, yes.
Yes.
Yes. Was that very interesting?
It's an honorary appointment, but you wear extra clobber and...
Yes.
On, you know,
yes.
Dressing up.
Fun for dressing up.
Look.
Well, now to get back to the serious, what is it about the world now that you think is so terrifying?
If we are not careful, we're going to run into a Third World War. And I think it is right that instead of going in invading Syria for the crimes they've committed and so on, Russia, China, Iran are on the edge, and if we put in force there, the Russians will step in to help Syria. And it can be the beginning of Afghanistan again.
Another.
No ending where it would stop. But I'm glad now I see the president of Syria has agreed to give up his chemical weapons. And if this happens, and it's not just a bit of talk, diplomacy must be the answer to this. You can't end this thing by conflict. It's got to be diplomacy. And will it work?
Do you think that in this era now, that it is the age of diplomacy? That it has to be the age of diplomacy?
It's got to be.
Yes.
I mean, all right, what happens if you release a nuclear bomb? You can't go into that area ever again because it's
radioactive.
Yeah. Oh, yes. It must be diplomacy. Mm. How you're going to do it, I don't know. The trouble on Syria is there are so many in the opposition, and there are so many different religions fighting. Mm. I don't know how they're going to sort it, but I think it's very worrying.
Yes, and it can't be through force.
That's right. Mm.
Yes. It's very interesting for me to hear a military man say that, and I'm reassured that you say that. That it has to be diplomacy.
Oh, no doubt about it. We mustn't invade Syria. Mm. How are we going to get over if the Russians play ball, and the president of Syria plays ball, and they get the chemical out of the way? Then I further diplomacy, we might get somewhere, but
yes.
Who knows?
Well, we're all hoping.
All hoping.
We are hoping, yes.
That's right.
Yes, and I think we need to write a few letters to the President of the United States and tell him we're hoping for diplomacy to win the war.
Yes.
Yes. Yeah. Thank you very much. I am amazed at how much you remember. I hope that I can remember as much when... How old are you?
Might be allowed to see this.
Yes. How old are you? Tell me now how old you are, if I can ask that.
Have a guess.
Well, if you're... You see, you must be around 90 because of having been through the war. But I'm not exactly sure. Are you going to tell me? Are you...
you go on, tell me how you say old I think I am.
Now, let me see. You're 50, you're 15 when you're at Sandhurst. No, you haven't given me enough clues. So you're 90-something.
What do you think?
Well, I know how old you are.
Oh, you do?
Yes, because you told Terry and myself when we had dinner with you the other Sunday.
Yes, that's right.
Yes, you're 103.
Wow.
I loved having you to dinner that time.
It was lovely to come.
I'm 103.
You are amazing. That is so
I'm
fantastic.
Impossible.
Well, no, you're not impossible, but that you can, you remember all this is wonderful. And you are keeping an eye on what's going on now, and that's also wonderful. And I'm looking at those pictures there. You're spotting your butterflies. It's a very good year for butterflies. Have you noticed that? It's a very good year for butterflies.
Yes, yes. I got my parents there. Father's shooting in Anglesey up there.
Yes, yes.
It's my mother on the top.
Yes.
I'm very lucky with family life.
Yes.
So there we are.
And there we are. Janet, do you think there's something else that I should be asking?
Did you come from a family that was in the army?
I have a lot of forebears in the army, yes, a navy. Now, we were yeoman farmers in, 1684, at Coxwell. And one of my forebears was the squire in Farringdon. And there is a glass window in the church in Farringdon in memory of Admiral Crowdy. And he discovered in Sydney, Western Australia, there is a bay, and it's on the charts now, Crowdy Bay.
Oh, yes.
And also the equivalent of a wildlife park, Crowdy Wildlife Park. And there are other soldiers before me. So I've got quite a military background.
I know that you've got an interest in sailing as well, haven't you? Was that just a hobby?
70 years, deep sea sailing, and... that's my first boat, and
How long is that? How long is it?
18 foot.
18?
Yeah. I sold one after the other, six of them, made a profit on each one, and 70 years was my hobby. I remember in the old family home, we had a pond at the bottom of the field of the garden, and I was only three or four, I had a plank on two oil drums. I've never stopped sailing since.
Wonderful.
And eventually when I sold them, the family were growing up, and if you got in a storm at sea, it wasn't easy to get to a port in a yacht, so I sailed up and had a punt on the Thames.
lovely. What was it? Where did you sail mostly? In the Channel or around the coast of Britain?
Oh, I had a boat to Hamble at one time. Eventually, I fitted down at Plymouth, and I used to sail to the Channel Islands,
yes,
to Norway and Sweden, and then France and Germany.
Yes.
70 years I'm talking about. 17 years as I was sailing.
Yes.
And yes, the flag of the Royal Naval Club and the Royal Albert Yacht Club, which I was privileged to be a member. My son-in-law, he was an Olympic sailor.
Was he?
He's standing in the bows there. We shared a boat at one time together. And I had the same crew for 17 years. A retired general used to do as he was told.
Well, I have
and,
to.
And a dusty old brigadier.
Very nice, very nice. I have done a bit of sailing.
Where?
I did cross the Atlantic from Leamington to Antigua.
Good going.
Yes.
I've never done it. My son-in-law has.
I was not in charge.
No.
And I was so innocent that I didn't know if it was dangerous. So I sailed along because everybody else seemed so confident. There were four crew and me. Everybody else seemed so confident that I thought everything was fine. Even in the Bay of Biscay, when you can look behind you and the waves seem like mountains.
Yes, that's right.
Yes.
Oh, many of you were brave.
No, I was foolhardy.
No. Come.
I think... No, wonderful. Wonderful. Thank you. It's just been lovely talking to you.
Well,
really,
I hope you... some of the nonsense you can cut out.
There's well, no nonsense.
No, I think you've been very good and very factual, as far as I can tell.
Well, thank you for coming.
Well,
tell me your name again.
It's Joe Lewington. And I don't know how much you will remember Bampton, but do you remember a little cottage called Sandford Cottage, which is by Sandford Field? You used to walk past there with your wife. And I think a little dog.
That's right.
Yes, am I right?
So, my memory is going.
It's not so bad.
Do you know, there was a... Oh yes, I know. I could not remember on the television how to get BBC 3 and 4.
Oh, maddening.
And I went to sleep worrying. And I thought, I tried all the figures and so I couldn't do it.
Yes.
And then after midnight, I suddenly woke up and then straight away I remembered how to get BBC 3 or 4 as opposed to channels 3 and 4.
Yes, yes.
That, my memory is...
I have those written down because I think BBC 4 is so wonderful.
Yes.
And it's press number 9.
That's right.
Yes, and that is the most important one to remember. They have wonderful programmes. Wonderful. So you'll have to have it written down somewhere.
Yeah.
Yes.
I've now my mentally... I've given up my... what you call it? What's the apparatus you type on and...
Computer. Typewriter? Computer?
No.
Computer?
Computer. I've given up my computer and also the memory recorder. I find it too complicated.
Oh.
I had to have the computer on the desk and it, a table there, and I had to keep on getting up and doing emails and so on. So I found it all too complicated, so I've given it up.
How old were you when you gave it up? Probably about 100.
Oh, only in the last 18 months.
Mm.
So at 102, you gave up the computer.
Yeah.
I think you are fantastic. There are people 40 years younger than you who won't even attempt the computer.
Physically, I'm... Well, I can't stand without a stick.
Yes.
I have a trolley.
Yes.
And I can just walk across my room.
Yes.
But to go down to meals, I have a trolley. Well, I've also got a bath chair, an electric chair, but I've got the most fantastic companion who will take me in a wheelchair, and we're going to the theatre in Oxford. That's as far as I'll go now to see Swan Lake, I think.
Terrific.
And the theatre make provision for wheelchairs.
Yes. I think they have to now. Isn't that marvellous? Isn't that marvellous? Yes.
Thank you. Three.